So T, you're back, and we have a new list to go through today. That's five more villains that we would want to see in a new Arkham game. There's two things to start out with here. One is this list is a little bit subject to change depending on when this game takes place. Very conflicting information on whether or not it's after the original Origins or Knight. So we'll get to that when we come to it, but that would change a couple of these characters significantly, especially one of them. And on top of that, the Arkham Asylum bios are and are not canon. It really depends on the bio. A lot of them have been retconned. Some of them are partially true, and some of them are just completely false. Like, Hugo Strange shows up as a villain in Asylum, and obviously, you know, he's really kind of making his villain debut in City. So, like, that was kind of a weird thing. But I think a lot of that is not really as important as the spirit of the bio to mention it, you know, because that's what we have to work with. So with that said, I think that's what we have to work with.
Yeah, I don't think it's necessarily as much of a timeline focus, really. It's just like more of a reflection on the lore and kind of exploring that in the bios that you see in like Asylum and then moving into in a lot of them. And the timelines aren't always perfectly aligned in these games.
No, and not even the events. Like with someone like Great White Shark, his connection to Mr. Freeze is kind of retconned later.
Right.
So there's stuff like that where it's just completely changed, or Harley meeting Joker. But it's still like the core of the character.
Yes, and this is just more see. These are villains too that we haven't really seen in the game, so it's just stuff that we want to potentially see, just bringing more spice to the new Arkham game that we're hopefully getting soon. So,
absolutely. So the first one we have is the Rat Catcher. And that's Otis Flanagan.
Otis Flanagan. Yeah. So he, you do see him in actually like his gear in three games in the Arkham franchise. You see him in Asylum. I believe it's actually in like a vent. You'll see his gear in there. You see it in City as well. There's a poster advertising his skills as an exterminator. And then you'll also see him in Origins, and not him, but his gear. And you'll see that by the My Alibi bar in the Coventry District. So
And he's such a funny, weird character. Like in terms of he technically used to be a rat catcher, and I guess he can still do that, but his whole thing is he can train rats to commit crimes.
That's such a weird thing.
He's very silly in a lot of ways, but I really like him. Even in like the comics, it was like he was smuggling things in and out of city with, or in and out of prison with the help of rats.
Which was...
it's really funny.
I mean, it's an entertaining villain.
Yeah.
And he's not as bad as, like, a Condiment King or an Egghead, you know?
It's
somewhat
the one,
practical,
I don't remember
I
the one you meant, like, Killer Quilt.
Oh, yeah. Crazy Quilt?
Crazy Quilt, yeah.
That's the one.
There's a lot of stupid villains in comics in general, and a lot of amazing ones. Ratcatcher is a weird, like, D-tier villain that really would work and add some, you know, variety of the game, especially since we've seen lore mentions to him. And he can't just be explained away like some of the bios in Asylum, because he keeps showing up, like that gear and those references.
Right, and not all of Batman's villains, and everyone knows this, but not all of them are serious gangsters that are legitimate, like, horrible threats
all
the time.
No, and not all of them are the Joker.
Some of them are just idiots, and that's fine, yeah. You know? Like, I think it'd be a fun villain, and that doesn't mean that he can't be, like, it can't be compelling gameplay or a compelling story still. But it's just what we have to go off of, so.
Absolutely. So next up we have the Clock King. Now, I know some of you have made recommendations of some of these. I gotta be completely honest with you. Since the channel, like, just blew up in terms of people watching and commenting, it's a little hard to keep track of all the comments. So in this video and maybe the next one, we might not have them in there, but we're gonna try to keep better track in the future if you mention something we haven't, you know, mentioned. But with Clock King, this is Temple Fugit. Our version of this and a lot of these is kind of based more on Batman the Animated Series. I would say we're the most familiar with some of these villains from that.
Definitely, yeah.
And he in the Animated Series is really weird.
You just watched the episode with him,
didn't
you?
I did, yeah. Actually, today.
Yes.
Because I'm rewatching through Batman the Animated Series. So, he's an efficiency expert. He's very odd. He's very, like, stuck to his schedule. Everything needs to be on time exactly. The first time you see him, he's complaining about the train being 6 minutes late. Stuff like that. Like, he's very OCD about time. Yeah. And then he's actually informed, I guess I should say, it's suggested to him by the mayor that, you know, maybe he should calm down because he has a court case coming up. And he should try to take some time to himself, go outside, you know, take a break from his, like, really confining schedule. He does that. Some kids, like, hit him with, like, a soccer ball. And then he drops his papers he needs for court in like a fountain. And then he shows up at court late and he gets fined millions of dollars. And so this is kind of what turns him to a life of crime. Like he like goes on a vengeance spree.
Because he's basically the poor guy who is always down on his luck, right? That's kind of his bit.
Well, that kind of became his bit in that moment, at least. Right. Before that, he was just the very, very, very strict businessman on a schedule. And then like something in him kind of snapped when that happened. He's really cool, like, his design. He has glasses that have the hands of a clock on them.
I didn't notice that. Okay.
It's really great. And he has, like, his sword is the hand of a clock.
Which is really cool, actually, yeah.
He's a really cool gimmicky villain.
Yeah.
That's a lot of fun. I know people hate time trials, but I think they've done a good job with them in the Arkham series. Like, think back to something like Zaz. You know, with the phone calls?
Yeah.
Where it's just hard enough, it's not really that big of a challenge unless you just completely botch it.
Right.
You could kind of do something like that with Clock King, where, like, you'd have to have a time element. You just want to make sure it's not annoying. So I don't know if it would be getting somewhere before a bomb goes off, or if it would be just, like, you know, interacting with Clock King in some way that you have to do something at precise moments, even, like, combat. There's a lot of ways they could go with that.
Oh, absolutely. And not to go backwards, but even, as you mentioned, a potential mission, it made me think of Ratcatcher. And you could do something, hypothetically, this is just, you know, very surface level, but if the Ratcatcher, if you were trying to find him, and it was like a crime scene investigation, you had to follow the rats or something. You know what I mean? Or something like that.
Instead of the DNA, like, of people like the assassin or whatever in City, you could essentially do something like that, yeah.
Which would be, you know, kind of fun.
The sky's kind of the limit with some of these characters, especially the weird ones.
And there's a few in here, so which is great. I like the uniqueness and the weird characters that show up in his gallery, in his rogues gallery. But moving on is Maxi Zeus is our number three option here. Maximilian Zeus, if you want to go with the long version.
He's someone I didn't know a lot about actually before researching this. I've heard him mentioned and I've seen some things from him in Asylum, but not a lot else.
Yeah, you see, I think his cell in Asylum. And then in City, you also see like a nightclub that's got his, you know, name on it.
Yeah, isn't that the Olympus one? The Greek Olympus?
That's the one, yeah. Yeah, so that's a huge... I guess cameo, I guess, for him as well.
Well, that's the thing too with these guys. I do want to point this out, is that when people bring up stuff like the bios, you know, like about how you can't rely on them, it is true, you can't rely on the bios completely, absolutely. But when we're also seeing things where it's direct references to these characters in the game, you can't just pretend that like Maxi Zeus's cell wasn't canon or something like that.
Right.
You know, it's not like a lore bit that you can throw away.
Or his nightclub, which is a giant thing in the city.
Yeah.
So it's there, it exists, and...
It's an asset in the game.
Right, right. And so Maxi Zeus, he was a former Greek history teacher who just kind of started to suffer from insanity when he lost his wife. He just kind of slowly went in, and then Batman tracked him down, threw him in the asylum. They didn't take him as seriously, so he broke out and then essentially teamed up with some Greek mythology-based superhuman agents.
Wait, so his whole shtick is based around Greek mythology, but so are his crimes in a lot of ways?
That's right, yes.
So it's like not only did he kidnap an Olympic athlete...
Correct.
But he also formed the new Olympians?
That's correct. Yeah.
Oh, no.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no.
Yes, please.
Very interesting.
Maxi Zeus.
Yeah, that would be really fun to see. I love those, like... I don't want to call them dumb because people like them, but they are sort of like nobody's taking them on the level of, you know, the Joker or Two-Face in terms of seriousness.
Right.
Villains like that are fun and they can still be a threat.
Well, that's the thing is if you wanted to go a dark route, there are, I guess, comic book iterations or like versions of his story where he got too many electroshock therapy sessions and that kind of just messed him up. So if you wanted to go a dark route, you could go that way. Or you could go a more fun, lighthearted way, too. There's not a lot of that in the Arkham games. It's a pretty dark game
and so,
in franchise, really.
And
so,
what you're mentioning is from, like, the Serious House on a Serious Earth. Like, what a lot of the Arkham Asylum original story was kind of inspired by.
Right.
In different aspects.
Exactly.
So, yeah, there's definitely ways you could go with it. This one is... It's funny to me, a lot of people have mentioned Killer Moth. I like Killer Moth.
I think he's interesting.
He's interesting. He's a little bit of a loser. He was a hired gun for gangsters. Batman kind of just cleans his clock completely a lot of the time. And
convincingly.
Yeah, exactly. And there is a cocoon hanging up in the aviary of Arkham Asylum in that game. So Killer Moth obviously killed someone there. It's implied that maybe he escaped when the Joker took over because he's not in the game. There was also maybe a reference to him in Arkham City, because in Arkham City there is a museum, and Penguin is using this museum, and he has different displays for different things. He has the assassin from the League of Assassins. He has the actual display for Scarface. He has like several of these up, and it looks like there's one implied to be for Killer Moth that has a bunch of moths in it, but it's empty other than that. So there are references to him throughout the game. He's also referenced in Knight, but you know what happened to him? It's really funny. So he's referenced in Knight that they kind of like say, I remember a BPD officer says, you know, we should be looking out for him. Like the GCPD should be looking out for him.
Yeah.
And then, however, it's also mentioned by one of the Black Mask thugs in the Red Hood DLC that takes place after the game's story. That Jason killed him. like he just happened to cross paths with Jason.
Jason!
In Jason's very early, like, first month of being the Red Hood in Gotham City. And Jason took him out. He just put him down. So that's why this list, a little bit, especially on that one, it matters timeline-wise where this takes place. Killer right. Moth works perfectly, I think, in an origin sequel.
Yeah, absolutely.
At some point in there.
For sure.
He does not really work in like an Arkham Knight sequel.
No.
Unless they somehow did a cop-out, like, he wasn't really dead.
Right.
Which would come across probably pretty lazy writing. I don't know how you'd do him there.
Nonetheless, yeah.
But he is a fan favorite, like a Z-tier fan favorite.
Yes.
So.
But people like him. He's a popular Z-tier, I guess you would
absolutely.
Say.
Absolutely.
I would agree. The last one is going to be Great White Shark, also known as Warren White. And we do see him in Arkham Asylum first, as far as the Arkham games. You see like a jar, and I think it has like his nose, lips, ear, and two fingers actually. So there's just, you know, remnants of him in Asylum that you see.
Yeah, and he's someone who you can't rely on the bio really for him. Like they even have this on the Arkham Wiki, how they actually retconned out some of this stuff. Like he had a connection to Mr. Freeze, but then they retconned that later. And then it comes down to like, well, what's real? Is it the comic book or the game bio? And neither one's that specific or reliable.
So you just have to take it with a grain of salt.
Yeah,
a little bit.
It's very much argued like which comic books are and are not canon to Arkham with the Arkham name on them even.
Right.
Other than like Arkham Knight Genesis, that's like the one that everyone's like, that's totally canon. Like, a lot of them are debated.
Okay.
So,
okay.
That's just worth pointing out.
No, it definitely is. Yeah, and he also shows up in Arkham City. So there's a sign in Amusement Mile that says W. White, so that's a sign to him, Warren White, and it's also seen in the Ra's al Ghul Trial of the Demon, and you also see something in the evidence room in Arkham Knight, where it's that same jar that you see in Arkham Asylum. So
yeah, so we know he exists in the world.
He exists in the world. We know that he's missing some limbs and some, you know,
yeah.
body accessories, but he still exists, and so we've seen him. He's kind of like a gangster. You made a good point. He kind of seems like a bit like Black Mask, kind of, but
in some ways,
in
yeah.
some ways.
I suppose especially surface level, but if you got down into the character, there are some differences.
Absolutely, and I'm not super familiar with him, but it does seem that he's just kind of like that, got that mob boss mentality almost, even if that's not what he is, and I'm not exactly sure, but he's got like a cool kind of freaky design to him, and he just kind of has like a scary appeal.
Well,
I guess
he reminds me a little bit of the Chameleon from Spider-Man in some ways, like design wise, except he's just more dark and gruesome looking.
Yes.
So
yeah.
Like that's really neat. I don't know. A lot of these villains would work. I'm not sure how they'd do this. They could very easily though do something with Great White Shark similar to what they did with Hush. I would just say you'd want to have a unique enough spin on it that it doesn't seem stupid.
Right.
Which is the same with any of these. You don't want them to just be a reskin of a previous villain.
No, and they did, and not to get into those games, but there were some side missions that just didn't get wrapped up nicely. They just got kind of thrown together,
yeah.
And then it seemed like they were built up really well for Knight, and then just kind of got finished. Like for me, for Hush, that's kind of what it felt like.
That was like.
Like
one of the most disappointing side things in any of the games to me.
For the build up in City, and then you get that in Knight, it just wasn't a great payoff. So I mean, you'd have to do something where it was a fully fleshed out side mission, I guess. Or, you know, it was fleshed out side mission, I should say. Where it was just, it's...
I think it's fleshed.
Is it fleshed?
I thought so.
I get confused.
I do too.
But either way, it would have to
all
be...
All the time. Someone will correct you in the comments. They do it for me.
That'd be great if you wouldn't
They're
mind.
Usually nice.
That'd be excellent. But yeah, I think it'd be nice to actually have a story with these side characters where it doesn't have to be these intense deep dives, but just something that's fun, that makes sense, and that has a sense of completeness, I guess, to it. You know?
Absolutely. So we'll have to see what they do. These are five more that we think could definitely fit, depending on the time of when this takes place. So we want to know, are there more villains that you think we did not mention that you would like to see? Who would they be? And what role would you like them to take in the game? Also, are there any villains that have shown up in the Arkham games that you think were not done that well that maybe you want to see more of? Maybe you want to see an expanded role for somebody? Let us know what you're thinking in the comments, and we'll see you in the next one. Have a great day.